change the subject. Is this the sort of book you give of Omar Khayyam? I am appalled.
It's beautiful.
It's a smutty book. It's a smutty book. Just you keep your dirty books away from my daughter.
They have no merit, and my response is grounded in the Roman Catholic Church's teaching on exegesis and the hermeneutical principle of literary genre of love poetry, which is found, for example, in the Canticle of Canticle, the Old Testament book that is a canonical book of the Old Testament, acknowledged as divinely inspired in every word by God himself, also known as the Song of Songs. The Catholic Church for centuries has consistently taught that any solution to understanding any literary genre of love poetry must first be offered at the hermeneutical level. Unfortunately, in the world today, people that criticize Luisa's writings have zero hermeneutical knowledge and credentials. Not to embarrass them, but simply to emphasize the fact that they don't know how to properly interpret sacred scripture. Take, for example, the book of Samuel, the earth has pillars, right? The book of Genesis, the sky is a dome. In the Gospel of John, Jesus says the Father and I are one, even though we know they're two distinct but inseparable persons. He didn't say one nature, but that was implied. So you have to understand, as Pope Pius XII in Divino Afflante Spiritu stated, that it is necessary for the interpreter of the sacred text, be it the scriptures, be it the approved prophetic writings of a mystic like Luisa, several of whose works have the official magisterial seals of approval, namely the Imprimatur Nihil Obstat, that they consider the writer, the sacred writer, as the living and reasonable instrument of the Holy Spirit. Now, how do they do that? They have to take into consideration the instrument, sacred writer's faculties, powers, vocabulary. For example, the Blessed Mother spoke to Bernadette of Superuin, Lord, in French dialect. She spoke an impoverished French because that's what Bernadette understood. So God lowers himself to our level of understanding as he did with Luisa. He spoke to her in Apulian dialect, which is an impoverished Italian grammar. It's imperfect. So the reader is not to interpret literally the words that the instrument of God uses to express his divine truths, which more often than not are not spoken. Luisa says in volume one of the principal ways in which God revealed himself to her was through a light of knowledge, meaning there were no words. Sort of like you get an inspiration in meditation or contemplation. And in that inspiration, there's a whole treasure trove of knowledge that it takes you a week to unfold. You have to reflect upon it, ponder upon it. But then you have to express it to a friend or a counselor to express what you experienced in your own words. That's more often than not the case with the prophets. This happened with Catherine of Siena, and Catherine Emmerich, Luisa Piccarreta, and the list goes on. And the very books of sacred scripture, although guaranteed as divinely inspired like the Song of Songs, contain many grammatical errors. This is a fact. But the substance is unassailable. So let me read to you, for example, a portion of the Song of Songs to give you an idea of how this can easily be understood as erotic and lewd when divorced from the hermeneutical principle of biblical exegesis that applies also to approved prophetic literature. Let him, meaning God, kiss me with kisses of his mouth. Your cheeks lovely, your neck. Ah, you are beautiful, my lover. Your lips are like scarlet. Your mouth, your breasts are like twin fawns. Your tongue, let my lover come. I have taken off my robe to open up to my lover. Your rounded thighs, your navel, I give you my love.
The lack of rigidity in your teaching that has made us feel that this is a real danger.
It's a guide to my whole way of life.
This is a canonically approved, inspired book of the Old Testament, approved by the church, not just the gist, but every single word is inspired by God in the context of the sacred writer's milieu, religious ethos, limited vocabulary, and intended expression. It's a love poetry, and it's not meant in the carnal literary sense as the Gnostics understood scripture, and that's why they were condemned. They considered the world as a dualism, the forces of immaterialism, which are good, and the forces of materialism, which are bad, including the flesh. So all the flesh was evil. Same thing with Manichaeanism, which was condemned by the early church from the second to the end of the fourth century, from the time of Irenaeus to Justin. This is unfortunately a resurgence of the old heresy of Gnosticism and Manichaeism. That is, the condemnation of Luisa's writing as being too erotic, too sexual, because the interpreter does not have the proper tools with which to interpret the sacred text. How do you interpret it? You have to, there's no equivocation here, you have to have knowledge of the original language. If you don't know Hebrew, you will miss the meaning of the Song of Songs. If you don't know original Puglian dialect, Italian, or even the standard Italian, in which Luisa's writings have been transliterated, you will not understand what Jesus is saying to her when he has these moments in which he spews into her mouth a toxic substance. It's not a moment of love, it's a moment of reparation. Every time he approached her in that way, it was never a matter of love in terms of romance, it was a matter of reparation. Why did he do this to her? Because he himself contained the bitterness of the sins of mankind, and she said, let me take upon myself your sufferings, my spouse. The book of Revelation chapter 19 speaks of Jesus as the bridegroom of us, the spouse of the bride, the mystical body of Christ, who will espouse him at the wedding feast of the Lamb. Catherine of Siena had a mystical marriage. John of the Cross had a mystical marriage. Teresa of Avila, and the list goes on. Hannibal de Francia had a mystical marriage with God. So there's nothing wrong with nuptials. It runs from the Old to the New Testament, from the first book of Genesis, where Adam and Eve have a nuptial encounter, and God is the presider, to God in the Old Testament in the book of Hosea, who says, I, Yahweh, Israel, am your husband. God is the husband of Israel, the body of the Old Testament, Kahal, the Old Testament church. And we find this nuptials in the humanity and divinity of Christ in the womb of Mary, and at the foot of the cross when he gives his mother John the beginning of new life. And we find it again in the book of Revelation chapter 19. So there's nothing that should scandalize us when we speak about God being our spouse, which is the goal of mystical union.
This is no place for you, woman.
Your faith has saved you.
You know what kind of a woman this is.
I'll give you an example of St. Faustina Kowalska. Jesus tells her, you are a sweet grape and a chosen cluster. I want others to share in the juice that is flowing from within you. What is this juice? So God sometimes uses words that are meant as an invitation of the Creator who made us to love him, so that we in turn could requite that love through an identical exchange of unconditional, self-sacrificial, unlimited self-giving. And that's known in Greek as agape. We also find that the pontiff, St. Pius VI, he put out an encyclical, De Verbum, and I'll quote portions of it to you to help us understand how we are to properly interpret the sacred text of the inspired writer. He states, the interpreter must investigate what meaning the sacred writer intends to express and actually express in particular circumstances by using contemporary literary forms in accordance with the situation of his own time and culture. For the correct understanding of what the sacred author wanted to assert, due attention must be paid to the customary and characteristic styles of feeling, speaking, and narrating which prevailed at the time of the sacred writer. And this is why the church avails itself of theologians, biblical scholars who know the original language of Hebrew, Greek, Latin, in this case with Luisa, Italian. So if the reader does not know Italian, do not listen to them criticizing Luisa. And guess what? Every single criticism that has come against Luisa has come from an individual who has no knowledge of the Italian language. What a surprise. How are they going to properly interpret her text and its intended meaning? They can't.
But there are those who think they are righteous because they say yes to God. But they do not do his will.
We will